presentation here. Is that okay?
The one that you gave it to me?
Mm-hmm.
You didn't modify anything?
No.
Energy demand and supply, right?
Yes. All right. So you hear me? Is it working? Yep. Okay. Good. Okay. Thank you very much. I'd like to start here. All right. So welcome everybody this morning. Good that you showed up in such large numbers, although it's pretty early. So I was asked to talk about nuclear power within the context of energy demand and supply. And like my section head who gave the lecture 2 years ago, I would like to add also something about sustainable development and climate change as has been developed in the past few years. So what I will be talking about, first electricity demand and supply, then I'll tell something about the sustainable development and the sustainable development goals defined by the United Nations. Then I would like to focus on the sustainable development goal of climate change mitigation. And then, of course, end up with some takeaway messages. So to start with, we have some challenges in the field of energy. It starts with the growth of population of the world. We had, in 2014, 7.2 billion. And which is expected to grow to 9.6 billion in 2050. On top of that, these people don't live homogeneously divided over the world, but they move to cities. Urbanization increases by more than 40% between 2011 and 2015. And economies grow at an average rate of 3.2% per year from 2011 to 2050. And in the business as usual scenario, as you know, I'll explain later. When forecasting the future, we use scenarios, but if nothing happens to current policies, we just go on as we always do, so-called business as usual, the world's energy, primary energy demand will be increasing by 70% between 2011 and 2050. And maybe you would say 2011, that's already 6 years ago. Yes, it is. And of course, they're changing a bit, but the principal idea remains the same. So we have pressure on resources, health and environment, and the sustainability calls for energy system transformation. So if you look at the graph, what do we see there? It's the distribution of the world's energy demand over the various fuels available. The black one, conveniently, is for coal. The light brown one is for gas. And the medium brown ones for oil. So this is the largest, over largest part of primary energy demand. It's fossil fuels. And on top of that, there's the nice colored ones, the yellow for nuclear, and the big green for bioenergy. The blue one for hydro and the other renewables. Well, they're also yellow, but the yellow on top. And we can see it's still very small. And the red line is the energy-related CO2 emissions. I'll come back to the end of the presentation to that. But what you see when we go on as usual is rising and rising and rising. So if we look at primary energy demand, first we look at the black line. That's the past. Well, we can be certain about that. It's only one line because that's what already happened. It's here measured in thousands, millions, tons of oil equivalent. And well, what we see is this little dip of the financial crisis in 2008. But then it's the overall trend is that it's rising. Then we look to the future. And then we look here at the International Energy Agency World Energy Outlook, where they define three policies. The red one, that's the so-called current policy scenario. That's if you take the current policies of the government and only that, without any, well, wishes or proposals and so, then you have this red line going up. If you have the new policy scenarios, it's the policies already implemented, plus the intentions and, wishes and, serious plans, so to say. And then you come to the blue line. And if you then go to real decarbonization, and that's what we've seen now as, the current wish to limit the rise of the temperature in 2100 to 2 degrees Celsius, then we go to the so-called 450 scenario, and then that is the green line. And that is really a policy where, additional measures have been taken that are really radical just to limit these CO2 emissions. Now, where does this number of 450 come from? Well, it means the 450 parts per billion of CO2 that is then the concentration in the air. So this is corresponding to these 2 degrees Celsius. So if we then move to electricity, first look to the past, we also see a rise and an accelerating rise. Here we can see some events that have been happening. It's at the beginning, the very left, it's the end of the World War II. Then in 1973, there's the first oil price shock. As we all know, oil price shock, then there was a going down of the world economy and also going down of primary energy consumption. But electricity went on and on and on. Second oil price shock in 1979, US recession, 1981, it may be slowing down a bit, but it's rising and rising. The only what was really giving a bump, that was the global credit crunch in 2009. That's the red pillar at the far right. But the general trend, it is rising. So if we then look into the future, these are these three scenarios again. 2014, and then the distributed over the various regional regions. That's in America on top and China on the bottom. It's not for any reason to do that. It's just to show from the largest to smallest region to the largest region, which with regard to energy demand. Then we see what's happened in 2014. And then additional is in blue. What comes on top of it in 2040? And then in the new policy scenario, that's the medium. And then if you go to the current policy scenarios, it's more. And when you go to the 450 scenario, it's usually less, the electricity demand. By the way, if you have questions, don't hesitate to interrupt me. Otherwise, I'll just go on. So first, I'll talk now about the traditional energy, electric power demand and supply. Where you see this traditional, on the right, we have the suppliers, and there's a coal-fired plant, there's a nuclear plant, there's a hydro plant, and all these put their electricity on the grid, which is transported over high voltage lines to the consumers. That can be a factory, that can be an office, that can be a residence. And why I call this traditional, and later on, at the end, we will see what happens if we add large shares of renewables to the grid. But first, the traditional supply. If we divide this over fuel and look at the past, we will see a large amount of coal over the world and small amount of oil. If we look 50, 60 years ago, there was a larger amount, but oil was then unpredictable for price and pretty expensive, so it was kind of pushed out the demand, electricity supply. So the fossil fuels are mainly coal and gas. The lower yellow bar is nuclear, and the large blue, the upper blue bar, the dark blue bar is hydro. And then on top of this, come the renewable, the new renewables. The green one is biofuels and The upper yellow one is wind, solar, and other intermittent renewables. So what we see here again is the same trend. It's on the rise, except for this 2009 dip. If we now distribute this over OECD and non-OECD, well, first, for all of them, it goes coal is a dominant source, and it stays that way. If we go look back to 1990 and compare this to the 2012 situation, it has shifted a bit, but coal is still dominant, followed by gas. Gas is very popular and has been rising a lot. Also, where hydro can be applied, well, still increase that. And there is some some growth in the renewable sources, but in this period it has not been very much. If you divide it over OECD and non-OECD, you see that in the non-OECD coal is even much more popular, it's applied much more, and also the rise of coal is much more. Nuclear plays also a role of in the OECD, it has been growing, and also non-OECD, it has been growing even more. But still, the percentage is pretty low still. Then the evolution of nuclear electricity production, if we concentrate on that. And we divide it over the various countries and look at the past. And what we see here is the most application is in European Economic Area and in North America. And in East Asia, there has been a growth, but due to Fukushima, it's, there's this large dip coming from. And now it's slowly recovering, but still this dip, because it's a cumulative graph is coming from there. In the meantime, also Germany has started their to shut their plants down, but this is less visible here. See here, Africa is very small. There's only two plants, but as we'll look in the future, this is planned to be more. But for some statistics, I think, well, we've seen this yesterday as well. 449 nuclear reactors are in operation, 60 are under construction. There is a almost 400 gigawatt installed capacity in 30 countries, and 12% of the electricity is generated per country. This is varying from 2% to even 73%, the famous French situation. This one we also saw yesterday, the plants in the construction versus in operation. The blue bars are the operational plants, and we see where the growth is here. That's the green bar in Asia, in the Far East, and it's the Asia, Middle East, and South East. That also has growth, and in the Central and Eastern Europe, Western Europe, and in Northern America, not really much is happening yet. This is a kind of complicated graph. I'll leave it a little. It's a power generation mix in the International Energy Agency World Energy Outlook scenarios. So this is what I was talking about first. We start here with the 2013 situation on the left. And then we compare the new policy scenario, NPS, with the 450 scenario, where you see that all these bars of the various fuels are lower. Here we see these different colors. The black, of course, is for coal again, and the large green one, no, the large orange one is of gas, and the nuclear one is the lower yellow one. And we see the general trend that at the 450 scenario. Oh, sorry. Yes. Yes, well, this new policy, it means what governments are pledging, what they're doing already today, what's in their legislation, plus what they are pledging for the near future. So it's the current sitting government, they've been elected, and so they say, okay, we have these new policies underway, or we're pledging to do that from that near term year going on. But for the 450, there's more going on. Then there's really a goal like, well, look, our energy our energy supply has to be decarbonized to that and that level. which means that much more of the fossil-fired capacity needs to be replaced by carbon-free capacity. That can, and then that it's equal whether it's wind or nuclear or hydro or whatever. It just doesn't, it cannot emit CO2. But there's no policy in place for that yet, and it's also not pledged yet. But that's the difference between these two scenarios. That is still, it leaves room, well, it's not, it's, it leaves an obligation for these policies yet to be created. And so this this 450 scenario assumes that this is going to happen. That these governments will create policy and they will implement it. And when this is happening, then we will see this scenario. Yes?
What was the criteria that you used to lead to the increase of nuclear energy on the 450 scenario? Because as we are seeing now, it's not increasing that way, actually, even with the policies that are for a greener nitrate. So how leads to an increase of nuclear energy on the nitrate?
How the nuclear energy can be increased? That's
the
question.
Yeah.
I suggest I will leave this question until the end of the presentation, because then the Paris Agreement comes in, and this has a very interesting mechanism which could, in this way, encourage nuclear to be realized. But and if I don't answer it properly, please come back. So now go to sustainable development and United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. So what is that? It are 17 goals to mobilize efforts to end all forms of poverty, fight inequalities, and tackle climate change. So it's all kinds, all things that have to be improved around the world. Well, affecting all factors of life. It's not just energy. It's not just nuclear. I'll show in the next slide what they are. But first, they are adopted by the world leaders in September 2015 at the UN summit. So it's a United Nations thing for all of the world. And in January 2016, they came into force. That's pretty recent. Before, there were other goals. These were so-called Millennium Goals. And but what they forgot there, for instance, there was no Energy Millennium Goal. So this is out of date. We have a set of new ones. Which is very handy for governments to build their policy on. And there's an action plan being defined for the next 15 years. So here they are. And here, okay, we're conveniently put number 7, affordable and clean energy in the middle, maybe because that's the area that we're working on. And we see with the other 16 goals, they are all in some other way connected to this goal of affordable and clean energy. Energy is really the center of means to realize all of this. So to pick out some, well, more related ones, there's the number 13. That's the climate action. And there's the number, which is it? Industrialization. And so we have affordable energy. It reduces the poverty and inequality, supports health, education, economic growth. And so that's the first one. The reliable energy is essential for industry, health, education. And there are all these goals that that just rely on energy. So what do we do with this? How do we quantify the improvement or what we can do from the energy side with all our different fuels? For realization of all these measures, these metrics of quality of life. So we use for this a life cycle assessment. This provides a consistent way to compare different technologies by accounting for the full impact over the life of each technology of producing an identical end product, so-called from cradle to grave. And in our case, we are always looking to the kilowatt hour of electricity. So to start with, how about the occupation of land, the goal 15? Life cycle land occupation is indicated here for the various fuels. That is required for the production of electricity. And we measure that in square meters here in a year per megawatt hour. And we see, okay, the colored ranges, they show low and average and high estimates. On the top is the solar thermal, then it goes to solar PV, wind offshore, wind onshore, biomass, hydro, the gas with the combined cycle. And then there's the coal with the carbon capture and sequestration. Oh, that's the upper gas as well, by the way. And there's the normal coal. And on the bottom, there's the nuclear. And what we see here is that biomass, well, of course, you know, is taking the most land for per megawatt hour generated. And those that are doing very good, it's the offshore wind, it's the gas and nuclear. What's wrong with the coal? They're taking just more land because of the mining, especially the brown coal mining. So this is a fine way to compare all these fuels in this on this metric. Now, can go to the next one, which is water consumption. It's the sixth goal, clean water and sanitation. Life cycle water consumption is then measured in the needed square, cubic meters per megawatt hour for electricity technologies. And water used in the operations, the dark green refers to cooling towers, whereas light green shows just withdrawals for the ones through cooling, which is the usual one. And there what we see again is that both nuclear and coal and gas, because they're thermal generating technologies, they require still a lot of water. And solar PV is doing better there, the photovoltaics. But biomass and hydro, yeah, they're dependent on water use and biomass production or evaporation, so they're doing quite long. Wind offshore and onshore are doing very well there. They don't need any water. Yes?
This is for
No, yeah, SMRs, they have the same principle of, the boiling water and the thermal cycle. So they're not more efficient or so. So they also need the water.
Yeah, but I mean that consumption is different.
Well, it is a little different because they won't need the large cooling towers. But the principle is still still similar. It's not that they suddenly don't need any water at all. So then we go to materials requirements. And that's the goal number 12 of the responsible consumption. The life cycle structural materials requirements. And then we have been looking at four materials. The red one is cement. The yellow one is aluminum. The green one is copper. And the purple one is iron. Of all these fuels, what would they need for per kilowatt hour? On grams per kilowatt hour of these different materials. And then we see suddenly that solar thermal and solar PV and wind offshore and wind onshore are not doing very well. Also biomass and hydro are using a lot of materials per kilowatt hour generated. And there the usual fossil fuels and nuclear are doing much better as being concentrated sources of energy, electricity. And then we go to human health. What we measure there is the various aspects of health impact. Disability, and we measure that in disability-adjusted life years, metric per terawatt hour generated of electricity technologies. And well, we go again through this whole list of fuels, and we look at things like ozone depletion, human toxicity, that's the yellow one. The purple one is particulate matter formation, and the green one is ionizing radiation. And then we also have photochemical oxidant formation. And we see that especially the fossil fuels are doing quite bad on human toxicity and on particulate matter formation. And of course, nuclear is this particular aspect of ionizing radiation. But if you take that into account in a quantitative way, it compares kind of positively still with the fossil fuels. Here, the renewable sources are doing very well on the top. Then the latter one, greenhouse gas emissions in comparison. That's over the life cycle. It's not only during operation, but also what is needed for construction of the plant and what is needed for decommissioning of the plant and, you know, tearing it down. So if you then compare, and then it goes in gram of CO2 equivalent per kilowatt hour. Why? What is a CO2 equivalent? It's not only CO2 that's greenhouse gases, but there are other greenhouse gases, like, for instance, methane, which have a different impact on the greenhouse effect. In fact, for instance, methane is 30% more severe than CO2. But if you then all calculate it to a CO2 equivalent, then you have one measure. And that's what's shown here in gram CO2 equivalent per kilowatt hour of electricity technologies. And then we show that especially coal is doing very bad, of course. We see that the other fossil technologies are doing better because of better efficiency. And there's the carbon capture and sequestration technologies, the CCS, that's supposed to, especially fight this component of fossil fuels. And we see it helps, but it doesn't help. It doesn't eliminate. It still it decreases to 25%. And, what we see here, nuclear and wind are doing best here. In fact, maybe you've seen that yesterday, the DDG also showed such a graph. That's a little bit older one. Now we have some move figures that, especially hydro, is not that positive anymore, can also, in some cases, even emit more CO2. So now I'll focus on this a little bit more, climate change mitigation. So first we look to the past. So if we would have generated everything by, let's see, if nuclear and hydro and other renewables were not available, this electricity had to be generated in some other way. And then more CO2 would have been generated or emitted. And this is what this graph is showing. The black one is the power sector actual, and the blue and yellow and orange one are those of carbon-free sources. So they have avoided the emission of CO2 by their operation. And so here the yellow bar is what nuclear has avoided in comparison. But these, if you look into the future, if we want to maintain this nuclear share, it's not something self-fulfilling. Then there needs to be some active action, because a lot of nuclear plants have come to quite a high age. And of course, there is some action on lifetime extension. But that's not everywhere. There are also countries that are actively phasing out, going the other way. Okay, very nice, but it needs to be replaced by some other carbon-free source. Otherwise, we just keep on emitting more. So here I have the age distribution of the operating nuclear plants. And we see that a considerable amount of plants are older than 30 years. So 3/4 of the existing nuclear fleet should be replaced by 2050. So now about the Paris Agreement. The United Nations has this annual United Nations Climate Change Conferences. They started in 1995, and the idea is to address this problem of greenhouse effect, the rise of temperature because of the increasing concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere. And for this, there is a United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, UNFCCC, and they have these conferences, which we call simply Conference of Parties, COP. The 21st was in Paris. Well, the third one is also very famous. That was in 1997 in Kyoto. Maybe you've heard of the Kyoto Protocol. The 21st was then in Paris with the famous, now famous, Paris Agreement. That is in 2015. Then, a turning point in the global climate action, but it's not an end point. It's the Paris Agreement, huge, historic, durable, ambitious. People are very, very happy. The goal is to limit the temperature rise to 2 degrees C, but also to aspire to 1.5 degrees C. And for the first time, this is important, this is a bottom-up. It's an action at the national level. And it's a design of rules, processes, and institutions on a negotiation for its entry into force in 2020. So it's just now an agreement, but it's not into force yet. The idea is now that all the countries come up with their nationally determined contributions. So everybody has to come in, well, I'm going to contribute this. What are you going to do? Well, build these and these plants and do energy conservation or close coal plants or whatever. And then they may show, well, this is going to bring so and so much. So this is a long-term goal. It's to limit the average global temperature increase to well below 2 degrees C, above the pre-industrial levels that aspires to 1.5, as I said. It's a clear signal to policymakers, businesses, investors, and the public that this low-carbon and climate-resilient economy is inevitable. It's providing a dynamic mechanism to take stock. I'll show that later on. It's very important. And strengthen the mitigation ambition over time. And it's setting up an enhanced transparency and accountability framework. And it has a solidarity package with adequate provision on climate finance. So countries that cannot afford all these nice measures, they're being helped by mechanisms by other parts of the world that happen to be more wealthy. And to address the links needed to adaptation, loss, and damage. That causes all these climate change effects. They're already going on. It's not something in the future. It's already happening that there's already damage to certain parts of the world. So this is what's happening. The black line on the left, that's what we saw before. That's the and it's going in a similar, it's a very similar form as the primary energy that we saw in the beginning. But this is the global total greenhouse gas emissions. And but then for the future, we can go three ways. At the current policy trajectory, if we don't do anything, just follow on with the current policies, it will cause in 2050 a rise of temperature of 3.3 to 3.8 degrees Celsius. And there's a whole scientific body doing all these calculations and coming up with these numbers. Now, every country coming to Paris brought their intended nationally determined contributions. We're going to contribute so and so much. And if we all add all this up, then you get this red line. Then it's going down to 2.7 degrees Celsius. But it's still not enough. It falls short to 2 degrees Celsius target. And a greater ambition from the countries is needed. And if we would, if that would work out, then we would see a real maximum in the CO2 emission, and it would be going down again. But until now, it's only rising. It's going to start rising more or less, but it's still rising. So the Paris Agreement emphasizes the role of incentives to reduce emissions. And there's these national mitigation targets formulated by the national determined contributions. There will be a price on carbon. There will be support, long-term policy orientation for investors. It is very in low carbon energy. It's very well understood that this is not something nice of today, of something politically fancy or fashionable of these years. And these investors must be certain that they will earn their investments also over the long term. Also important, the RD&D investments, research and development and demonstration, and technology transfer, and the policy incentives serving joint purposes of sustainable development. Here I highlighted the Article 137 It also recognizes the important role of providing incentives for emissions reduction activities, including tools such as domestic policies and carbon pricing. So the message to all the different countries is choose and design the policy instruments that are best suited for implementing your country's NDCs. So this is how it works, the Paris Agreement. In 2015, it's on the left, there's the Paris Agreement itself. And then the intended national determined contributions were submitted. Then in 2018, there will be a pre-2020 review of global action. That is that the scientific body is going to look at, well, what's happening in reality today, who's emitting what, and how does it all add up. Then in 2020, we get a renewed agreement. In 2050, the development, emission development strategies, and countries submit their targets for 2030. And that can include, then, technologies that are not available yet or at the moment too expensive, but they can say, okay, then it will be available, so we make it a policy to implement. So this will include, or possibly include, it's just an option, some kind of innovative nuclear technology. And then in 2023, there's coming this scientific body again. Oh, it's the first global stocktake. What effect does it have? Maybe it's even better and we need to take less action. But most probably, there will be just a confirmation. Okay, go ahead. We need more reduction. So, and in 2025, the countries are asked, well, what's next? What are you doing now? I have still a new nuclear technology that wasn't available before. So that's an option. See, and that's how it's all going on. It's 2013, there are new targets. 2035, there are new targets. And it all offers the opportunities to bring in new technologies. And on the bottom here is based on the latest science. There's this Intergovernmental Panel of Climate Change. They provide these reports in 2018 of the impact of the 1.5 degrees Celsius and related global greenhouse emission pathways. The 2 degrees C target can, it will reduce from 2010 the greenhouse emission benchmark from 100% to either 40 to 70% in 2050. That's the 2 degrees C target, and the 1.5 degrees C target has a cut into even 70 to 95%. So that is really a lot. But all of them, they aim to cut emissions to even zero. And the 2 degrees C target is doing that in 2080 to 2100. And the 1.5 degrees C target, it pulls this even forward to 2060 to 80. But the idea is the same. So it's just not only about mitigation targets, it's also about adaptation, loss and damage. It's about financing, this technology development and transfer, capacity building, people being helped with that, transparency of action and support. So there's a whole legal part on this, compliance in cooperative approaches. So the Paris Agreement also explicitly emphasizes innovation. It's upscaling of public and private RD&D. There's a so-called Energy Breakthrough Energy Coalition. And it's, of course, not only about nuclear. In fact, there is still a lot of discussion about nuclear. Nuclear is quite a controversial technology because it's still a lot of countries, they either exclude it explicitly or they just avoid the topic. They're not really clear on whether to apply it or not, just avoiding it. But if we, from the side of nuclear knowledge, people can help this, with providing, this is what we have, this is the technology, we can develop it in this and this way, and it will be ready then and then, we can make our contribution to that. And the innovation is pivotal for the expansion of nuclear power. So, and on the right bottom, I put some examples. What's so innovative of this nuclear power then? At the moment, we have only these big nuclear plants. It would be nice if it would be more scalable, smaller, larger plants. Of course, there's always a discussion about enhanced safety. Can Fukushima happen again? how can we prevent it, and how can we clear that it's prevented in simple words? And can we build plants in a cheaper way, which is in a modular way, constructed easier and especially faster? Do we need 7 years for construction? And flexibility of utilization. Is it only electricity that we're producing, or can we also use the waste heat? Or maybe even sacrifice some of the electricity production to produce high quality heat? So various advanced concepts are already in different stages of development. And so the Paris Agreement may even be another incentive to proceed with this development and then bring in these concepts explicitly as well. This is contributing to the climate change mitigation. And within these nuclear power development, also the challenges of nuclear power can be addressed, so that countries that at the moment say, well, no, we don't apply nuclear power because Fukushima, because the waste, because, well, whatever, and then you can say, yeah, but now we have a new development. There's no Fukushima anymore, and the waste problem is addressed in this way, that the waste is being not waste anymore, it's fuel. And so then these countries might change their mind. And what are we doing then as IAEA, International Atomic Energy Agency? Well, we are producing, of course, well, what we know, we're trying to put that in nice reports, not only thick reports, also brochures like the Nuclear Power in the Paris Agreement, which is a nicely digestible 8-page brochure. We, of course, are having our website. We are also translating the documents in other languages that are spoken in the large parts of the world. So examples are the climate change and nuclear power reports that are produced once every 2 years or sometimes every year. Nuclear power and sustainable development. We have one report on nuclear power and the Paris Agreement. That's this brochure. And there was a special of the IAEA bulletin on climate change. So I'm coming to the end with some takeaway messages. So to meet the scale of energy demand in the future, well, we propose to use all low carbon technologies. It's no source can be, we don't have the luxury to say, okay, we don't apply this or that source because, well, whatever reasons there are. It's all outweighed by the need of low carbon electricity, low carbon energy, so you'll want. Nuclear has significantly contributed already to the greenhouse gas mitigation. But now it must accelerate growth. And even to do that, it must replace old plants, and that is an active action. It's not something that's already in the policies or something. You hear often, well, to attain the level of nuclear electricity, well, we have to do that and that. Well, this is not something self-fulfilling or so. But this is, in every country, this is an active decision of some government. It's usually not some utility deciding about an investment, but everywhere it's an issue of national importance. So it's decided in the parliament. And so this has to happen everywhere. If it doesn't happen, then the nuclear contribution is going down. Okay, then it has to be replaced by something else, which is probably not there. So we have to do something about that. And what do we have to do? Well, how can we contribute to this? Well, trying to reach out and trying to explain the cause in as simple words as possible, and trying just to convey the message, not only tell each other how nice nuclear is, but just let's try to explain to the world outside our nice bubble. So the recurring character of the Paris Agreement, and that's the good news, it offers an opportunity for innovative nuclear power. And some people say it's too late, but never too late. Now, of course, the first thing to help is life extension of existing nuclear plants. That's helping the Paris Agreement and the climate change mitigation most. But then we cannot just stay with that. plants are getting older and older, they really need to be replaced, and let's take the chance now to do this with really innovative nuclear power. But we, from the agency, we are poised to support the member states' plans for nuclear in implementation of the Paris Agreement. So, I would like to thank you and ask you for questions. Did I answer your question properly in the meantime? Okay, good.
Just one quick question. Regarding the Paris Agreement, what's your opinion on the future, taking into consideration that the United States has decided to withdraw from the Paris Agreement?
Yeah, well, I think with the United States, that's something very temporarily, because the reason that they withdrew is because the current administration wanted to support the coal industry in the United States. So, well, maybe they open the mines again, and then they find, there's no one to buy these coal. And so then they'll soon enough come back, because also these climate change effects will be visible and felt in the United States as well. So I'm not that worried. Also in the United States itself, many of these climate policies, energy policies, they're not regulated on the federal level, but on the state level. And various states already say, well, it's very nice what you're doing in Washington, but we are going on with our Paris Agreement compliance policies. So I'm not that afraid for it.
In the context of the Paris Agreement, how will the developing countries survive? Take it into cognizance that most of these developed economies used coal and other fossil fuel to develop their economies. And now they are selling the idea of greener energy to the developing countries. When we know that some of these renewables are not sustainable, they cannot actually kickstart industrialization in some of these countries. I don't see, do you think it's a good idea for the developing countries to buy into the Paris Agreement? Or what's the way forward for the developing countries in the context of the Paris Agreement?
Well, I think, of course, the developing countries can take advantage of the whole, I say, technology development and accompanying cost development of all these energy technologies. That in the early days of the developed countries, coal was burned in a way that's absolutely not acceptable anymore. It was emitting not only CO2, but also all kinds of soot, and people got immediately health problems living in there. So it's not possible anymore, not for developed countries, but also not for developing countries. So coal is not that cheap anymore as it was in the early days. That's something in the past. So you can transfer, now it's our turn to burn these large amounts of coal, otherwise we cannot develop. But on the other hand, the developing countries can take advantage of the cost reductions of the other technologies, especially to start with the renewable technologies. The good thing is that usually a lot of developing countries are in very sunny regions. So they could start with that. And of course, then use the proper mix. That's also something we do at the agency. Start with these countries to do their energy planning and train them on computer tools where they have to put in what's their expected population growth, what's the development of the industry, of businesses and everything. And then what's your resources? So what would this source cost particular in your country? And then there comes this mix out and doesn't exclude anything. So also coal is possible. But then on top of this, there could be a policy. Well, look, we have been signing these Paris agreements, so we are pushing a bit these carbon-free sources. But of course, there will be an elasticity, but which comes to an end. If then it appears that the PV, well, also the nuclear, is too expensive. Yeah, sorry, then we've debated for a while. But at the end, it's still possible, but it's also beneficial, and it's even necessary. That also because the climate change effect, it affects all countries in one way or the other. And especially developing countries are usually in hotter areas of the world. Yeah, they're in need of most of the, in need of that, that this temperature rise is being halted somehow. So, and this Paris Agreement, it also acknowledges very much the strong shoulders and the weak shoulders. You know that the developed countries are helping also with financing constructions, the developing countries to do their part in their country. So, bottom line is, I think also for developing countries, it's a must, but also benefit to sign the Paris Agreement and to implement the policy according to it. Yes. So what you mean, there are a lot of uncertainties if you...
Yeah.
If you know.
And like, for example, you try to get a people to a repository, it's very difficult to get people. Or for example, for newcomers, somebody that trying to build a power plant, the cost that from initiation to finally get through is that
So first of all, this and of course this life cycle assessment, it takes into account a lot of assumptions, and yeah, that's something you have to live with. Also, it has to say something about nuclear, so it also assumes something about what is the decommissioning cost, what is the final repository cost. It all goes in there. And if you dig very deeply, of course, then you can see, yeah, well, wait a minute, that particular number I don't agree with is much too high or too low or whatever. So, and therefore it's important that you have many people to do such life cycle assessments and gain some consensus and compare this among the various research institutes all over the world. And of course, then you will find some outliers of, well, Greenpeace will do their own study and find, well, nuclear is way expensive. And and also, well, maybe the nuclear industry will do it the other way around. Anyway, the idea is that, of course, there will be assumptions. And yeah, if you have done such a slide, of course, I cannot put all the assumptions. Even in the reports, sometimes they cannot be found. But that's something. Well, maybe we or these institutes can be working on how to communicate these assumptions. Because otherwise, people will just either use this because it fits their purposes, or reject it because it doesn't fit their purpose, and they can't see where these numbers are coming from anyway. And what was the last question you had?
There
was
a one question. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Iron.
Yeah.
If you look at the nuclear, other materials are very important to prevent it. While it's not like it is, can you explain it?
Yeah, with uranium, that's a very interesting one. Of course, it's difficult for these comparative life cycle assessment because all the other sources don't use uranium. But, there's this famous red book of the OECD and IAEA. Doing forecasts on available uranium. And they do that in a very scientific way. They say, okay, there's these very assured resources. We know they're the mines, and they're reasonably assured resources, and they're very probable resources, and so on. But to cut a long story short, at the end, it's all about the demand. Of course, when the demand is so low as it is now, because nuclear is not that popular, well, you see uranium prices are dropping. And what you also see is during the years before Fukushima, there was the so-called nuclear renaissance. It was more and more countries were interested in nuclear. And what we saw is then a rise in uranium prices, because the expectation is that more uranium would be used. So what happened is there was more exploration. So nothing happened to the to the forecast of available uranium, because there was even so much used as there was found again. And we see the same phenomenon in the oil industry. There was this huge outcry in the 1970s of the Club of Rome, oh, we're running out of oil. But then exploration went on, and went on with new technologies and with more energy, because there was so much demand, and they found just as much as they were using. So also with uranium, we've seen this happening just on the short term. But with uranium, we have some other peculiar things. There was also the weapons program of the, what do you say, there was an agreement between US and Russia of demolishing their old nuclear warheads, and they were converted into nuclear fuel. And this was quite a lot. It kind of, well, distorted the market for the mines. So this was another resource. And on top of this, there is also the prospect of using fast reactors, which is also going to make uranium prices drop very much if this is really going to happen. And then on top of this, there's the resource of seawater, where there's also, well, there in the sea, there are many minerals, and one of the elements occurring there is uranium. And there has been several efforts to mine, to farm this uranium from the seawater. The moment it's more expensive, four times as expensive as mining the uranium. But yeah, of course, when the mines are getting more depleted, well, this is becoming more and more interesting. But it gives some kind of bottom line that we would never be running out of uranium ever. So I'm not that much afraid for it. Who was first? Yeah, you go first and then you. It also includes the producing, yes.
Okay, because I know, like, the producing of the solar panel can be very toxic. So why the impact on human health, solar panel is so low?
Yeah, well, what you see is with solar panels, the production happens in a very controlled way. Especially this vacuum controlled area is just needed. Otherwise, you cannot make it. So it's a natural, I say, a natural boundary to, well, the humans that are just operating the process. So there's a natural distance, I have to say, to this production process. And it's always, with very small quantities and very, these high-tech vacuum production facilities. So that's something else, as for instance, coal, where they have these huge mines, and you can put up a respiration device, but it's only limitedly helping. And I guess that's kind of, overall speaking, the reason. If you look to the production process, it's just more, health-friendly for PV. Although, I agree, these materials are pretty toxic. That's true. Yes?
Yeah, I have a question regarding the film's life, because I haven't seen the exposure for radiation for the coal miners, let's say. It wasn't taken into account, or?
That's a good question.
It might be because I read some articles where also the miners for the coal, for example.
Yeah. Yeah, so what you mean is there this bar of ionizing irradiation should also be the present in the cold bar.
Yeah,
I think that's a very good point. I will take it to my colleague who made this.
I have to find the source also. Maybe I can share it.
Yeah.
In fact, we have a lot of discussion on that, on the radiation protection. Especially on Friday, we have a discussion. We talked about various sources of energy and the impact of radiation being deployed in various sources of energy. Like, you know, you avoid an answer or explode into it.
Okay. Any more questions? No? Okay, then I can give the floor back to you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Anik, for a nice, interesting, lively presentation.